Well, hello everyone, and welcome to this part two review of the Chill Dreams add-on. The Chill Dreams add-on is an add-on that allows you to basically do these kind of screensaver flyovers over your content, but it's also a little bit of gameplay too, in that it introduces a new mob into the Minecraft universe, the Dream Turkey, as well as some other things like memory jars and dream journals and those kinds of things that you can use to play around in your world and potentially use that as a way to set up your world to have the best possible screensaver. But in this part two review of how the add-on was built, what we're going to cover today is a set of different scripting APIs that we used in building this add-on that you could also use in maybe building your own add-ons as well. So just to kind of kick us off here, the first thing we'll take a look at is the item start use and item stop use APIs, as well as the modal form data APIs. And these APIs are really used to implement a little bit of the user experience of the Chill Dreams add-on map. So just to show you a little bit of how this works and when we get started, here you can see I'm in my world and I've got the cooked dream turkey, which, well, it's kind of a purple chicken, but when I actually eat this turkey like this, you know, I can eat the turkey if I so choose by just using my right click button in this case. But if I eat it for a certain while, that kicks off our dream mode. And when you kick off dream mode, one of the things it'll do is it'll pop up a little bit of a user interface to ask you how you would want to configure your dream. I can click submit. And then from here, what will happen is that your dreams get kicked off and you'll start to fly around different locations inside of the world. In this case, I'm apparently in the middle of the ocean, which is not super exciting, but you can use this user interface to configure the different types of places that you'd like to go see and go use. So if we take a look at the code architecture, before we get started, let me go tab into the code that you can see here. You can see I have a scripts folder and the set of complete samples is available in the description below through the link on the github.com/Microsoft/Minecraft-samples GitHub repo. But what you can see here is we have a number of different TypeScript classes that actually implement a lot of the logic for how this add-on is put together. And specifically, we have an architecture where the main function that we have here is main.ts. And this has actually a lot of the most interesting bits and pieces of the code that you can see and that we'll get into. But there's also this dream.ts class, which actually handles the process of kicking off a dream sequence. The entire time that it's flying you over the world, you're inside of a dream, and dream.ts handles all the logic for managing that. Now, when you're in a dream sequence, what happens is we do these like 30-second flyovers over different parts of a space inside of Minecraft. And when it gets done, it'll actually take you to a different location and then fly you over that piece. And so this is what we call a dream track. And so a dream is just composed of a never-ending set of different dream tracks that you can fly over. And the dreamtrack.ts file is what manages that. Then there's also a set of memories. Memories are sort of waypoints or landmarks inside of the world that you can use to kind of navigate between, but then also that's also an anchor point for how we would show dreams. So if you, for example, build a really awesome castle and you want to make sure that your dreams are always flying over those castles, you can create a memory, set it into the world, and we will randomly use that inside of dreams to fly over your castle. And memoryset.ts mostly, for the most part, like just handles the process of saving all those different memories inside of the world and helping you to navigate across them. So it's basically just a memory tracker. So actually, if we go ahead and dig into this code, the first thing we'll probably focus on is that initialization of the dream sequence that we started with. And so to show that, that's basically us in this code base using the item start use event and the item stop use event. So you can see at the bottom of my type here, I've got world.afterevents.itemStartUse and stop use. And this basically subscribes us up to these events. And from within this type, this is where we actually handle the logic of what happens when you start to eat a dream turkey. And you can see in the start item after use event, what we do here is we just say, okay, if the type of thing that a person is using is our cooked dream turkey element, what we're going to do is we're going to track the starting tick for when they started eating. And then in the stop after item use event, if they're done actually eating a turkey, what we're going to do is basically just check the time to see that it's over 60 ticks, or essentially 3 seconds. And if that's true, then what will happen is we'll actually go ahead and kick off a dream. So in other words, if I just simply take a nibble at my cooked dream turkey, it won't kick off a dream sequence. No, In order to start a dream sequence, you really have to start eating that turkey. You have to go for 3 seconds at least in order to kick off your dream sleep. That kind of mimics the whole effect of, hey, you're eating a turkey at Thanksgiving and you'll get tired if you eat too much turkey. So that's just a quick example of using the start item after use and stop item after use events to actually go track the dream. Now, inside of the start dream sleep function, this is where we actually go ahead and kick off the dream. You might have noticed that we set a message that says, hey, you're getting sleepy, and we set that title to fade out over time. There's a little bit of a funky thing here where the control over the fading in and out of the title and the action bar sequences is managed in the set title function, even if all that we're using here is the action bar text. So I do a little bit of a dorky thing here and I just pass in a space because we don't actually want to set the title. We just want to set the action bar that's in the middle of the screen. I then use the camera APIs to actually fade out, fade to black essentially. So you can do some very simple fade outs here. And in this case, I'm setting the fade out time and the fade in time in terms of seconds that people will go use. And this is what actually goes ahead and sort of kicks off the dream sequence that people are looking to kick off. Now let's get a little bit into the user interface that we're invoking in order to kick off the dream sequence. There is a function in the server UI Minecraft scripting namespace called modal form data. And what this allows you to do in kind of this builder pattern that you see here is actually configure the dialogues that we're gonna go show to a player. So we're gonna say, oh, actually I called title twice. That's kind of a funny thing. I shouldn't do that. I only knew that once. And then there's a number of different toggle functions here for the different checkboxes, for the different options that will come into play for configuring how a dream will work. And what we'll do from here is there's a modal form that will be shown to a player. This actually causes it to all pop up. Now, keep in mind, there's potentially some error cases or some results where you don't get a response back. So for example, if you pop up a dialogue, but the user escapes out of it, or like for example, if there's like a multiplayer thing going on, or there's a number of different conditions, sometimes the player won't have an opportunity to fill out this dialogue. So you do need to be careful about the response and to make sure that there are actually response form values that you can then go handle. And then what I do is I read these response.form values and I use those to further configure how the upcoming dream, this dream object that I've created up here, how that's actually going to go run and process and go throughout the world. So this is just a quick overview of using the start item events, the modal form data, to essentially implement an item that you can hold in your hand. And when you use it, it causes some interesting things to happen. This is a very common technique that, you know, a lot of creators use. Maybe they're doing like a debug stick or some other type of control mechanism, and they want to pop up some UI when somebody uses an item. This is just a quick review of how this was done in the Dream Turkey add-on. Okay, so next up, we actually want to talk a little bit about how the actual dream mode was implemented. So to show you that, let's just go back into our dream real quick right here. We'll go kick off that dream. You can see the action bar text. You can see the user interface. We're going to go say we want to go navigate around random different places. And what you can see from here is that this will then take you into the dream sequence. And again, I'm flying over a random part of the ocean in front of an island. And one of the things that you'll maybe notice is, a few things. One is that the user's interface, the hot bar, the paper doll that you would see in the upper left-hand corner, that is no longer shown to a player. But in addition, and you can't see this because my camera's not turned on, but I'm moving my mouse around. I'm trying to configure what I'm looking at, but that's actually not changing at all. The perspective is always flying straight ahead and looking straight ahead and those kinds of things. So in this sense, the player input has actually been limited. So let's take a quick look at how that works. One of the things also to know is that when I actually hit the control key down and hit the W key to actually kind of try to move ahead and to sprint ahead, that actually takes you out of the dream sequence. So now I'm back into the normal flow of Minecraft and, you know, here's my friendly dream turkeys and my wolves and those kinds of things. So that's a little bit about how dream mode is implemented. And if we take a look at the code behind the scenes, one of the things you'll see is, okay, now I'm in the dream class and I'm going to call .activate. And in this activate function, you'll see a few things that happen when a dream actually kicks off. And the first thing we actually do is we call a function called preserve setting. So when we go into a dream state, we want to preserve the player's like current location, what dimension that they're in, and we want to persist that with the player so that when the dream is over, we can restore them back to the location that they start from. And this is very important. You don't want to get a player that's like stuck inside of a dream mode that they can't get out of. And so at every opportunity, we want to preserve the settings. And if the user is no longer in a dream mode or they want to go do something else, we want to make sure that we restore their settings back so that we don't leave them stranded inside of a dream that they can't wake up from, as tragic as that would be. So coming back to the dream, if you hit, let's see, control, not that. If I just go back to the activate function like so, you can see that the other thing that we do here is we actually use this spectator mode to actually put the player into a mode where they're basically hovering around like a ghost inside of the world. Now this takes away a lot of their user interface elements, their hotbar, their paper doll, those kinds of things. And as far as other players are concerned inside of the world, they can't see them. And so this is actually really ideal for this dream sequence, that basically we have this whole mode that makes them fly around like an invisible ghost or mostly invisible ghost inside of the world called spectator mode. So we call player.setGameMode, GameMode.spectator to turn that on. And then the final thing that we do here is we actually go ahead and turn off the player's input permissions. So this is a new API that we've exposed inside of Minecraft. It's got a number of different properties that allow you to configure what a player is allowed to do. If you, for example, wanted to do a cut scene or you wanted to do some sort of animated sequence, what you're going to want is to control the player's ability to actually change their camera view. And you can do that with the input permissions type. Let me go dig into this one. Actually, I turn off their ability to actually change the camera perspective, to move their mouse in my case, to change their camera view, to go turn that off. So the input permissions is very powerful and very common. Like I said, if a creator wants to go do something like a cutscene, then you're going to want to go turn off their camera permissions to go do that. So that's a little bit about set game mode, spectator mode, and the player.input permissions APIs. And the final part of our API tour that we want to take you through is how we actually move players throughout the world in the middle of their dream. And to do that, we have this function here called dream track, which we talked about earlier. And there's a tick function that basically gets called every single tick, which is 20 times per second. And what you can see here that we do is we actually take the player who is in the middle of the dream, and we take the interpolated point between two other points, and we actually teleport them to that point along with their rotation so that we're always looking from that player's particular vantage point as we move them along the track, as we move them along in the middle of their dreams. We use the player.teleport function to do that. Now you might be wondering, well, there's this camera functionality. The camera functionality might be a great choice for moving people throughout the world. But to understand why we actually use player.teleport, it's probably important to know a little bit about how Minecraft actually loads content and works with content inside of the world. One of the trickiest parts of using the API is that, for example, when you're getting a block, and of course getting a block is a very common thing to do inside of the Minecraft API, getting block will return it undefined if that block is not loaded yet inside of the world. And so, for example, if you want to find where to put the player for their dream, and you want to put them, you know, 20 blocks above the topmost block inside of the world, if that API returns an undefined block, then you have no idea as to where to put the player for their dreams because you don't know where the topmost part of the world is. Well, then the next question is, well, how do you control Minecraft loading behavior? And the important thing to realize is that Minecraft, what it tries to do is within the render distance around a player, when a player is in a particular location, it's going to go ahead and load all of the chunks around that particular player. And if you're not familiar, a chunk, think of that as a 16 by 16 block column of blocks that are inside of the Minecraft world. So when you're looking in front of you, you're seeing all the blocks in front of you, you're seeing, you know, dozens of different chunks worth of blocks that are laid out in front of you for, you know, as long as that goes into the render distance. And when you first go to a new location, when you teleport to a location you've never been before inside of Minecraft, what's going to happen is that Minecraft will then go load all of the chunks around you. And you can see that typically it looks like a concentric set of chunks that kind of get filled in over time. And on my PC, for example, you can see here that, you know, that's relatively quick, but it's not instantaneous. And certainly on other devices, you know, maybe devices with a little bit lower spec or a little bit of a slower of a disk or something like that, the actual time it takes to actually load all those different chunks can take a while. And I say load, but it could actually just be generating those chunks. In the case where you're visiting a part of the world that you've never been before, it doesn't have any chunks stored on disk. What it has to do is generate them for the first time. And that can also take some time based on the speed of your device and your CPU. So all this to say that when you teleport a player to a new location, the hard part about managing the dreams is that that whole area might not be loaded yet. And so you don't necessarily know where to put a player that's such that they're floating 20 blocks above the world to implement how their dream works. And so what you actually have to do is you actually have to go ahead and try to strategize your loading process around that whole concept of a dream. And so to do this, what we have is this algorithm that will first teleport a player to a new place to kick off that dream sequence. And what we'll do while we're kind of waiting for all of the chunks to get loaded in is we're gonna go try to test for random points to see if, like, okay, can this be a destination point for our dream? And then if yes, if we can actually set up, if that chunk is now loaded and we can go navigate the player to that point on the world, because it, again, it is now loaded, what we're going to do is we're going to then go generate some interpolated points between that point and where the player is, just so that we can navigate them up and down along the terrain as we go fly over that bit of the terrain. And because we're only going to load 10 or 20 chunks into the distance at any one time, what we'll do is we'll get the player moving in a particular direction. And then as the dream progresses, as the track continues, what will happen is we'll keep generating points off into the distance as more terrain gets loaded so that we can keep the dream track going. In summary, this is just a strategy for progressively generating points that we should fly the player to as the content all gets loaded inside of Minecraft. And that's the reason why we use player.teleport rather than the camera, because moving the player to a particular location is what causes all of the chunks around that player to actually get loaded. If you just move the camera, that's not going to force Minecraft to load any more chunks necessarily. And so that's why we don't use the camera. We use player.teleport. We call that, as you can see here inside of this code, 20 times per second to actually move them to a new location. So that's a little bit of the backstory about chunk loading and loading blocks and being able to interpolate a path for their dream track that is actually a little bit more complicated than you might have guessed in terms of the implementation for the Chill Dreams add-on. But undoubtedly, as you work through your own add-ons, wrestling with how chunk loading happens can be a little bit of a challenge. Hopefully in the future, we'll have some more APIs so that you can more explicitly manage or at least have an event for when new chunks get loaded into Minecraft, so that you don't have to just try to test for things and hope that chunk will get loaded ultimately. But today, if you want to write a lot of code that does things off in the distance from where the players are, you're kind of a little bit more limited to doing things like trying to manipulate the player location. We do have something called ticking areas where you can actually manage and force manage the process of loading an area, but there's only 9 ticking areas that are allowed to be used inside of a map, and you have to be very careful to use them, well, very carefully. So in that was just another choice for something that's intending to be an add-on. We don't want to consume too many of the player's ticking areas on our own add-on. So that's another option for managing ticking areas and loading chunks and forcing the behavior of loading chunks, but that's just an option that we didn't use inside of this world or inside of this map. So that was a bit of a grand tour of the major APIs that we used in the Chill Dreams add-on in our scripting pack. We had a little bit of the overview of the class structure of the packs. So definitely take a look at the code, dig in, and see how things were implemented. Of course, everyone has their own strategy for how they choose to want to implement things, but hopefully this introduced you to some new APIs that you can use in your own add-ons and your own techniques for managing the process of building some awesome add-ons. So thanks for watching, and check you in the next video. And also, by the way, please like and subscribe if you thought these tips were cool and fancy and pretty swell. Thanks for watching.